Yeah, welcome again to the lecture course on relativity and cosmology, part one. So today we deal with the last chapter of the winter term, and this is chapter 8 on the Schwarzschild solution. What is the Schwarzschild solution? So the Schwarzschild solution is an exact solution of the Einstein field equations in vacuum. And it's a solution that describes the geometry outside a spherically symmetric body. So we have here a spherically symmetric body of whatever constitution with mass capital M, and we are interested in the exterior. I mean, in relativity 2, we will also be concerned with the interior, but for the time being, we look for the exterior solution. So we have here then an exact, this is important, exact solution of the vacuum Einstein equations in the exterior of this body. And this solution was, as the name indicates, first found by the astrophysicist Karl Schwarzschild, who lived from 1879 to 1916 and found this solution in 1916. So solution found in 1916, actually while he was serving at the Eastern Front in the First World War, and he also died from a disease that he captured during the war in the very same year. Now, what is the form of the Einstein equations outside the spherical body in the vacuum? Now we recall, I mean, we have the Einstein equations R mu nu minus 1/2 G mu nu R is a kappa T mu nu. So we could also, or we have already done so, write this in an equivalent form. So we calculate a trace of this and substitute. So we have here then trace of R is related to trace of T, and substitute then here the R by this. And then you get here the form R mu nu, and then something that has to do only with the energy momentum tensor. Now in vacuum, of course, the energy momentum tensor vanishes, so it's clear that you can write down the vacuum Einstein equations in this form. Now, for vacuum, R mu nu and of course R vanish, and so the non-trivial part is then really contained in the Riemann tensor, not seen in the Ricci tensor. So, well, actually later when doing the concrete work, we will use this form, because in that case it turns out to be quicker. But in general, I mean, that's the important form of the vacuum Einstein equations. Now, for Newton, in Newtonian physics, we have here already the solution. I mean, we know that the gravitational potential phi of R is given by minus gm over R, and we have discussed this in the earlier chapter 2. So instead of this one function, we have now, of course, the 10 functions for the metric, and we are interested in finding the explicit form. Now, Einstein also thought about this after he has finished his completed his theory, but he thought the field equations are so complicated that it will not be possible to find an exact solution. And actually, when he calculated the effects in the solar system, to which we will come in chapter 9, he used a perturbative solution that was sufficient. So he was very surprised when he received a letter from Schwarzschild from the front in the war with these exact solutions, and he immediately organized its publication in the proceedings of the Prussian Academy. And in fact, we will see how the generalization of this solution reads in general relativity. Now, the important ansatz, of course, is spherical symmetry. How do we write down a metric that is spherically symmetric? So we have here the ansatz for spherical symmetry. Now, mathematically, one can say the following, that a manifold with a metric is spherically symmetric if and only if it allows an SO3, so this is the rotation group, as an isometry group, no? Because then you have this axis and you can rotate around this axis and you have the same situation. And the group orbits being two-dimensional space-like surfaces with constant curvature. So let me first write this down. So we call M, so this curled M is the manifold G, spherically symmetric. Yeah, if and only if M G allows SO3, not a three-dimensional rotation group, as an isometry group. So if you apply the rotations, then of course you will not change the metric, the geometry. And with the group orbits, which is the result of application of the rotation, so with the group orbits being two-dimensional space-like surfaces with constant curvature. Now, this is the mathematical formulation of the intuitive idea of spherical symmetry. So this means these two-dimensional space-like surfaces means that these are two-dimensional spheres. So we have to use the line element of the two-dimensional spheres. And this is known to be, I mean, of course, the omega squared is the theta squared plus sine squared theta times the phi squared, with the usual interpretation of theta and phi as the spherical angles. Now, this means that this, of course, has to be separated away, and we are left with the line element. So there are two further coordinates, which we call T and R, so a time-like and a radial coordinate, and we call them here T bar and R bar, because we shall make some transformations and reserve the unbar then for the result. So we have T S squared is minus some function of R bar T bar dT bar squared plus 2 G bar of R bar and T bar dr bar dt bar plus a function j of r and t dr bar squared plus r bar squared and a function h bar of r bar and t bar times the omega squared. And so the important point is that we have here separated out the omega squared, which comes from the orbits of the rotation group, and the rest is just name so far, and with a time-like and a space-like coordinate. Now, of course, we can make use of the freedom of coordinate transformation in this two-dimensional coordinate regime. I mean, this is fixed, certainly, but we have a freedom here to redefine those coordinates. We can make a coordinate transformation in the R bar T bar coordinate plane while preserving spherical symmetry. So, and this will be done in two steps. So the first step is a new radial coordinate. And what we shall do is to define the new radial coordinate such that this here, what is in front of the omega, is the new R squared. This has the advantage that the area of this two-dimensional sphere is 4 pi R squared, which is the same value as we know from the flat space context. So in spite of this just being some coordinates, which have no direct meaning, we can of course choose adapted coordinates so that they are geometrically preferred. No? So we will have here to have this here to a new coordinate, so that this will RBR squared. So which means that we have the surface area 4 pi r squared. No? So this brings us, and I skip then the bar from this here, lead then to a ds squared is a minus, okay, this is then a different function. This is why I skipped the bar, but some function of r and t bar, t bar squared plus 2g of r and t bar dr dt bar plus j of r and t bar dr squared. And I make, of course, here everywhere where r bar is, I make this transformation. And here this gives the standard form r squared d omega squared. No? So that is what we shall keep here. And now we have fixed the freedom for the r transformation, but we can still make use of the freedom for finding a new time coordinate, and we shall choose it such that the form be simple. And this means we shall choose it such that this non-diagonal term vanishes and that the new form will be diagonal. So let me do this here. So we have here B, then is a new time coordinate. And so we choose t bar as a function of r and t. So this is the already chosen new r, and this will be the new t. And it's clear then you have the differential of this is then dv over dt dt plus dv over dr dr. And it's easy to insert this here. Yeah, so you have, you replace the t bar by this function v, and you replace the dt bar, which occurs here and here, by this. And what you get is then the following form of the line element. You have then ds squared is minus f dv over dt dt squared minus 2 dv over dt f dv over dr minus g dr dt, and then the remaining terms which are untouched. And you see here we can now choose our v such that this vanishes. So we want to have this equal to zero, and we get from this then that v of r and t, I mean it's just a simple integration, is a dr g over f plus some function of t. So it's not needed to go into specific forms. It's clear that you can, whatever you start with from g and f, you can choose a v such that this vanishes. And this brings then the spherically symmetric line element into its standard form, and we write it as follows. So this brings then standard form for the spherically symmetric line element, which I write as d s squared is a minus e to the 2 a r of t dt squared plus e to the 2 b of r and t dr squared plus r squared d omega squared. Now, so instead of these f's and g's, I have used these new functions e to the 2a and e to the 2b. The reason for doing this is to express the fact that this here is positive and this here is positive, so that we really have here the minus connected with the temporal part and the plus connected with the spatial part. So we have reduced the ansatz by this mathematical reasoning to a form where only three, where only, sorry, where only two free functions are involved. And these are the two free functions, A of R and T, and B of R and T. And just by symmetry, we cannot further determine them. We have now to insert this into the vacuum Einstein equations and solve them with for A and B. And this is what we shall do or sketch in the following. Of course, I could have, from the very beginning, started with this as a natural ansatz. Yeah, so you could just intuitively expect to write down for spherical symmetry something with the angle apart and then this T and R. But I found it more pedagogical to start from a more general form and to show you that you can arrive at this. Okay, so the next step would be then to calculate the Einstein tensor for this metric, yeah, and determine A and B from, well, I wrote down R mu nu equals zero, but here it's preferable to have the Einstein tensor. Actually, turns out to write this, it's most convenient to write this for these mixed components with one upstairs and one downstairs. This is not clear right now. It becomes clear when one goes into the details. Now, of course, then this would mean a lot of work to do. I mean, I have the metric ansatz and I have to calculate the Christoffel symbols by the first derivatives. From these, I have to calculate the Riemann tensor by other derivatives and also by taking squares. And then I have to make the contraction with the metric to get the Ricci tensor and so on. So this can be done, and Schwarzschild had done it. But it's a lot of work, and we know now mathematical methods that were developed in the 1920s that lead to a big shortcut of the calculations. And these methods, going back to Cartan and others, make use of differential forms, and we will learn this method in the chapter 10 in Relativity 2. So this is why I do not do the calculation here. You will understand it later when doing the chapter 10 that we will have a very elegant way of doing the calculation. I just postpone it. Anyway, if you like, you can play around with calculating Christoffels and R's. It's straightforward. And if you allow yourself many hours, then you will arrive also at this. But I think it's for now a waste of time to do that. And you can, I think, believe me that we will be able to do that and find the Einstein tensor. So what this calculation gives, so calculation using differential forms. So C, chapter 10, gives, okay, so we have here the equation that we want to solve. And so this calculation gives G00. And what comes out is minus 1 over R squared minus E to the minus 2B prime over R. Minus 1 over R squared. Okay, the prime is the derivative with respect to R. The dot will be the derivative with respect to T, as usual. So this is G00. G11 is E to the minus 2B, 2A prime over R, plus 1 over R squared, minus 1 over R squared, and G22 is by symmetry, it's the same as G33, because these are the angular directions and it does not matter where on the sphere and which directions you are. This is a longer expression. I write it down. Actually, we will not even need it because it will be satisfied identically, but for the sake of completeness, I write it down. So it's a complicated expression over r minus a prime b prime minus e to the minus 2a. We have b double dot plus b dot squared minus a dot b dot. So then for what is lacking is there's a non-diagonal value for g01, so 2e to the minus 2b minus 2b times b dot over r, and the remaining ones, they all vanish. And especially you will see the merit of this new formalism because it makes explicit use of the spherical symmetry and it directly shows you which components are zero, whereas in the original way you don't see this and you have to really calculate, and at the end you have many zeros which you actually would not need to calculate. You will understand that in chapter 10. Now, having this equation here, we have to set now all of these to zero, and these are differential equations for a and b, partial differential equations, because a and b depend on r and t. Now, of course, we want to do it as simple as possible, and the simplest as possible is to have this short equation first. So if you set this to zero, because all this here is positive, it means b dot is zero, which means that b can only depend on r. So that's a very quick calculation. So g01 equals zero gives immediately b dot equals zero. So we have b is b of r. So one of the two functions we already see cannot depend on time. Now let us address here these two. Okay, look more complicated, but you see here minus 1 over arc squared is here, and also this term is here. So if I make the difference between the two, only these a prime and b prime terms are left. So if you do here g11 minus g00, then this gives you 2e to the minus 2b over r a prime plus b prime equals 0. And this means that a plus b can only be a function of time, because that derivative or the derivative with respect to r vanishes, no? Which means that a plus b is a function of time, and it's a convention to call it 1/2 q of t. So that's the second result after this. So let us have a look at the line element, which is written down here. So far, I mean, we then have ds squared is minus e to the 2a plus dt squared plus e to the 2b dr squared plus r squared d omega. And if I insert then here from this that 2a is multiplied by 2 is q minus b, then I get minus e to the minus 2b e to the q of t dt squared plus e to the 2b dr squared plus r squared d omega squared. No? So you see here we have this combination here, but we can call this a new time coordinate t tilde. And you see, after having done this, only one function b is left. So here this we can call a d t tilde squared. And it's clear, yeah, that dt tilde squared is e is times is this. So if we use t tilde instead of t, then it's clear that a plus b, I mean, for the tildes, is just zero, because it would mean that here the q would be zero. Now I skip the tilde and call it again t. And so we have that thus far, then the line element. So, okay, skip tilde in t tilde. So we have now a plus b equals zero. No, for this new time coordinate, so that we have ds squared is e to the minus 2b of r dt squared plus e to the 2b of r dr squared plus r squared d omega squared. So you see this already these treatments already simplify drastically the form of the line element. We see that we only have one function left to determine, and this one function is only a function of r, so that the t has disappeared. I say something about this later, but we have to determine the b, and we have not yet made use of all the equations. We have certainly used g01, so that's taken. We have used the difference between the two, but we can still then use one of the two. And also there's this equation. So let us use the g00 equal to zero. So g00 equal to zero. And you see this is just then with b of r, an ordinary differential equation for b of r. So we can write this as a minus 1 minus e to the minus 2b, 2b prime r minus 1 is equal to 0. And so you have to solve the integral. I mean, by the separation of variables, you can write as db over 1 minus e to the minus 2b, e to the 2b is integral dr over 2r. No? So you see we have reduced it now, the solution of these complicated equations, to that elementary integral. So that's all what is left here. And I will now solve this and come to the result. So we have now this form of the line element with one function b of r. And I have shown you that the problem was reduced to one integration for this b of r, and this is that integration. And you can do it. I mean, you can convince yourself that, okay, this gives the logarithm of 1 over 1 minus e to the minus 2b, if you do the calculation, plus a constant. Now this constant is open so far, and we have to determine it from physical consideration. But because of the dimension, I mean, this has a dimension of a length, we want to choose it in the following, that c is the logarithm of a length, and I choose here the length 2gm, or 2gm over c squared. You recall this is the so-called Schwarzschild radius, and this choice will become obvious then in a minute. So I will justify it then later. Of course, you could leave it open and then just make the calculation with a general C and determine it then at the end actually from the Newtonian limit. And then you can just, then you get this, and then we get from this that r is, or I can directly write down gm, 2gm over r, which is dimensionless, is 1 minus e to the minus 2b absolute value. Now, of course, this would leave us two possibilities. I mean, this absolute value, we choose the sign such that we get here e to the minus 2b is minus 2 gm over r. And this is because, again, because of the Newtonian limit, if you did choose the other sign, this would formally correspond to a negative mass, and negative masses are not physically reasonable. So this is why we choose it here, because only this gives the correct Newtonian limit. And so we have finally, if we insert this here, so here, this we have then here and here. And so we get from this that ds squared is a minus 1 minus 2 gm over r, dt squared plus 1 minus 2 gm over r to the minus 1 dr squared plus r squared d omega squared. And this is our result. And this is called the Schwarzschild metric, or more precisely, the Schwarzschild metric in so-called standard coordinates, because you can use other coordinates, and we shall make use of other coordinates later. But this is the standard form. So this is the Schwarzschild metric in standard coordinates. Perhaps if you were attentive, you remember that we have not made use of all the equations. There were these complicated G22 and G00 equations. And fortunately, they are identically fulfilled. I mean, we have fixed the functions. And so if the formalism is consistent, of course, G22 and G33 must be fulfilled. And this is actually a consequence of the Bianchi identities, as you can convince yourself. Now, I should make a further justification of this 2gm. Here, I mentioned already the Newtonian limit. So, justification of 2gm. Maybe for completeness, I should put the speed of light here, which is set equal to 1. But at least, I think, for the final result, we should have here also the speed of light. No? So then you have the correct dimensions. Now, in section 6.2, we had a linearized approximation. And there we had the linearized line element, which is of the following form, minus 1 plus 2 phi over c squared. OK, here I put the c, so it's better to do it also here above. C squared dt squared plus 1 minus 2 phi over c squared dx squared. And if I put here the phi for the spherical symmetric situation, which is minus gm over r, then, and again I have c equals to 1, minus 1 minus 2 gm over r dt squared plus 1 plus 2 gm over r dx squared. Now, I mean, this factor 1 plus 2 gm over r, of course, arises from expanding this 1 minus 2 gm over r to the minus 1. So you might say that, okay, it's clear that this leads to that, but there is still a difference, I mean, between this dx squared and here the dr squared and the d omega squared. So actually, to make this more precise, this correspondence, we use different coordinates, and I will so-called isotropic coordinates, for example, and I will give to them in a minute. But already from here, you see, I mean, the connection definitely here for that temporal part. As I said, we have here the occurrence of the Schwarzschild radius, which I had introduced earlier, 2gm. And okay, you see a problem here, a potential problem, because here, if small r is 2gm, then this is 0 and this is even infinite. So we cannot use that solution as it's written down here for r, small r smaller or equal than this, and we also have to discuss this later. I already remarked earlier that we get here the result that this depends only on R from the field equations. So the metric is static, but this has not been assumed, so it actually followed from the spherical symmetry. No? So remark, metric is static. So this is a consequence of spherical symmetry. For the vacuum solutions, I should say. And this was not clear very early that this is direct a consequence of symmetry. It has been formulated by Birkhoff in 1923, and this is why it's also called the Birkhoff theorem. No. So this is called the Birkhoff theorem. I mean, you can generally prove, and in principle the proof has been done in the course of this calculation, that we have spherical symmetry in vacuum leads to staticity. There are also more in more recent time theorems about almost Birkhoff theorems, which means if you perturb a little the spherical symmetry, then the metric is static up to small perturbations. Now, this has interesting consequences. So as long as the object is spherically symmetric, even if it vibrates, but if it vibrates radially, the metric outside is unique. It's a static Schwarzschild metric. So whatever goes on, motion inside the body, as long as it's spherically symmetric, outside you don't see it. No? So this is one, or maybe the first example of a uniqueness theorem. Uniqueness theorem that one can prove in the connection, especially in the connection with black holes. And for black holes, actually, it was proven, and black holes we will only introduce in the next semester, so I will not say much about this, but I should mention that for black holes, one can prove the opposite. So if one just assumes staticity, no, that outside you have a static solution, then only spherical symmetry is allowed. And this is what was proven by Werner Israel in 1967, so much later. Of course, at a time when people then dealt with black holes. Okay, this is only a side remark, and let me leave it for that. Now, but what about the singularity at the Schwarzschild radius? Already Schwarzschild in 1916 was worried about that, and this is why he wrote a second paper in 1916. So he was concerned then about the interior solution, and he found an interior solution for a particular situation, as we shall see in the summer. So, but I write this down here. So Schwarzschild in 1916 in a second paper. So he found a solution of, well, I should say a spherically symmetric solution, found a spherically symmetric solution of, static solution of Einstein's equations in the particular case of constant density with rho is equal constant. And he found a very satisfactory result, satisfactory for him, because he found that a static star must have a radius that is bigger than 9/8 times the Schwarzschild radius. No? So that means that a static star, and in 1916, only static stars were imagined by astrophysicists, that they must be bigger than this. So the Schwarzschild radius lies inside the body and is therefore irrelevant, because this here is a vacuum solution. And what he found here inside was a regular solution, no singularities. So he thought, this solves the problem. The singularity is irrelevant, and we have outside the body the Schwarzschild, but the body is bigger than the Schwarzschild ranges. No? So in this case, in this case, a static star must have a radius bigger than 9 over 8 times the Schwarzschild radius. Okay, we know, of course, that the stars can also be dynamic. They can collapse, and there are supernova explosions and so on. But later theorems, they confirmed actually is also for dynamic stars. Of course, the until really they collapse, and they can collapse below the Schwarzschild radius, but then they will evolve into a black hole, as we shall see in the chapter 11. So they will no longer remain stable. So stable objects one can show even if you don't have this condition, and even if you omit staticity, when they can oscillate or whatever, have this condition. Of course, interesting is then what happens for the black hole. So the object, then when the star crosses the Schwarzschild radius, there we will also see in the chapter 11 that this is only a coordinate singularity, and then we shall be able to find coordinates, for example, so-called Kruskal coordinates that are entirely regular at a Schwarzschild radius. This is very interesting, so please stay tuned for the summer term to learn about interesting objects such as black holes. Now, I briefly mentioned that here, now this is the standard form, but you can have other forms. In particular, we can have another form where we can have a rigorous understanding of this connection to the linearized limit. And I leave the details as an exercise, but I will sketch it. These are the so-called isotropic coordinates. So this is then an alternative form of the line element. We use a different radial coordinate, an r going to r bar, and it's defined by r as 1 plus gm over 2 r bar squared times r bar. Okay, so this is uniquely invertible for r bar bigger than gm2 over 2. So this is uniquely invertible for r bar bigger than gm over 2, and this corresponds to r bigger than the Schwarzschild radius. So anyway, that's the regime we are interested in. Now, I mentioned that the Schwarzschild radius lies inside the body, so there's no problem with going from r bar to r, but also from r to r bar. Now, actually, this here corresponds to the Schwarzschild radius in a new coordinate. So you see that if you have new coordinates, of course, the expressions can look differently. No? So never attach absolute meaning to coordinates. It's a simple exercise to transform the line element from r to r bar. The only thing to do is to have to calculate a differential. Dr is a derivative of this with respect to r bar, of this times r bar. And I only give you the result. So then this would be an exercise that you get then ds squared is minus, and then you have here 1 minus gm over 2 r bar over 1 plus gm over 2 r bar dt squared plus 1 plus gm over 2 r bar to the fourth power dr bar squared plus r bar squared d omega. Now, so that's also an interesting form, because these coordinates are also sometimes used. And these coordinates are also called isotropic coordinates, or this is called the isotropic form of the Schwarzschild metric. Why? Because this here looks like the flat space dx squared. No? So this here looks like a dx squared. And so this is called the isotropic form. The isotropic form of the Schwarzschild metric. Now you see, for example, here, if you insert here the Schwarzschild radius, which is here the GM over 2, you always see that this is already regular. No, there's no singularity. Of course, if you insert it here, you still have here a zero, so something happens, but this gives you an idea about the possibility to choose coordinates that lead to a regular line element. And this is actually the form that is better suited for deriving the Newtonian limit or the linearized limit, because from this then you directly have here this dx form and you directly get this. And so even if you from the very beginning left the constant in the integration open, then this connection with the linearized approximation would fix this to be that you write here gm and so on. So that's important. Now you fix gm by the limit, which is, yeah, it's in a one hand it's natural, but on the other hand it's still a bit subtle because it brings in the gravitational constant that is not there in the vacuum Einstein field equations. No? So the vacuum Einstein field equations, capital G mu nu is zero, there is no gravitational constant because the T mu nu term is absent. So you have somehow to get this by the Newtonian limit. Yeah. So we have found this important and very central solution. The Schwarzschild solution describes the vacuum outside a spherical symmetric body. Let us try at the end of this chapter to get some intuition about the geometry of this. Geometry of the Schwarzschild solution. Okay, and the Schwarzschild solution is of course a solution of four-dimensional geometry, so four dimensions are not so easy to actually visualize, but here we can make important assumptions, or we have important properties, I should say. First, it's static, so we can go to t equals constant, no? Because it looks the same at all times. So here we can make a cross-section of the Schwarzschild metric for t equals constant. So this is staticity. So we have a three-dimensional geometry, but recall we have spherical symmetry. So spherical symmetry means that we can make another cross-section at a constant angle. Like with the standard sphere here, I mean, you can make any cross-section, you don't lose information. So we can also use theta is constant, we choose pi over 2. I mean, this plane, so this is spherical symmetry. Yeah, because this only would give the same at all times, and this would just mean you can just rotate and have the same. Now, so if we then have ds squared at t equals constant and at pi, theta is pi over 2, then what is left from here is that term, and here only the part for the polar angle, which is here r squared d phi squared. So we have here, then this is 1 minus 2 gm over r to the minus 1 dr squared plus r squared d phi squared. So this is now a two-dimensional line element, and as such it should be easy to visualize, because we can try to find an auxiliary space, an auxiliary flat three-dimensional space just for the visualization, and embed this two-dimensional surface just to see how it would look like if it were embedded. Now, so we call this sigma squared. So we embed this. So embed this surface for visualization into a three-dimensional Euclidean auxiliary space R3. Now, so this R3 has no physical meaning, it has only mathematical meaning, so that we can look on it and see a surface that has the same geometry as the cross-section through this four-dimensional space-time. Now, because of the symmetry, of course, it's suggesting to choose cylindrical coordinates in this R3 and look there for a rotational surface with the same line element. No? So we choose cylindrical coordinates z, r, and phi in R3 and look for a surface z of r with line element d sigma squared, with line element d sigma squared. Now, so the line element, of course, in R3 in cylindrical coordinates is well known. So this is dr squared plus dz squared plus r squared d phi squared. And of course, we look for a surface z of r. So we have to replace the z by z of r and compare it with this. So this means that we have here dr squared, and we have 1 plus dz over dr squared. That's by replacing, you write dz, this dz over dr, dr, and together with this dr squared, this is what you get, plus r squared d phi squared. And this must be the same as our d sigma squared, which is dr squared times 1 minus 2 gm over r to the minus 1 plus r squared d phi squared. No? So you see you have to compare the two, and this gives you an ordinary differential equation for z of r, actually of first order. So you just have to perform one integration. So compare this here with this. And this is simple. So the comparison yields that you have dz over dr squared is 1 minus 2 gm over r to the minus 1 minus 1, no? Which is, you can write as 2 gm over r minus 2 gm. You see already from this, I mean, if you go to infinity, then this goes to zero, which means that the surface becomes what we say asymptotically flat, not z. The derivative of z with respect to r goes to zero. And you can directly integrate this by an elementary integral. So what we get is that we have z of r is plus or minus square root of 8 gm. And then we have square root of r minus 2 gm. No? So that relation you have, and this is what we call a rotation paraboloid. No, so this is a rotation paraboloid. And how does it look like if you sketch it? And you have nice graphs in the literature, but let me nevertheless sketch it here. So you have this z of r over r. Yeah, and say we have here 2gm. No, because this is here a critical value, so this is the curve here in this plane is a parabola, and you rotate it and you get a paraboloid. So you get here, I mean, you have here this parabola that have here, oops, does not look as very nice when I draw it, but I think it's clear. So you rotate that, so you would have here, I mean, the same. And so you rotate it here. I think you can imagine, you can also draw here coordinate lines here and here. something like that. No, I think at least you can imagine how it looks like. And you see here this that you have here asymptotically the flat planes here, two planes here. So here, I mean, it flattens here down. And so you get here asymptotically flat planes. And okay, this is how it would look like, I mean, from a visualization, if embedded in this auxiliary space. And this was first discussed by Einstein and Rosen in 1935. And this is why it's also often called the Einstein-Rosen bridge, because it looks like, but it has this actually two branches, so two asymptotic flat regions. And so it's only present outside this Schwarzschild radius. It connects, I mean, connects to asymptotically as a bridge to asymptotically flat spaces. So this is asymptotically flat, and this is here asymptotically flat. It's also called a wormhole, or Einstein-Rosen wormhole. There are various wormholes in general relativity. Yeah, okay, you can imagine the worm going through this hole here. One can, of course, visualize this in other ways by using other embeddings, and I can only refer to the literature for this. But I think that's still the most important visualization we have. And of course, we are interested also then to see what happens if we go here in this interior. I mean, of course, this is no longer applicable, at least not around the Schwarzschild radius. So we have to take care for that by finding other coordinates. And we do this in the chapter 11 on the black holes. Okay, so thank you for again attending this online lecture course. So that's the last lecture of this winter term, well, except for a brief lecture that I will present with an outlook on the next semester. No, so stay tuned. There will be again a small lecture where I summarize what we have done so far and where I give an outlook of what we still have to do, and this will basically be the subjects of black holes and cosmology. Okay, thank you for today.